What's the meaning of life?
I don't know.
Life is, I don't know.
We'll explore that question and more.
I don't want to say sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
On the next 700 Club Interactive.
Well, thanks for being with us this morning. Today, we're going to try to find an answer to one of the most frequently asked questions of all time. What is the meaning of life?
Well, that's what we asked people in the middle of Times Square, New York, and we found out their answers were quite varied. Take a look.
Meaning of life.
I don't want to say sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
I don't know. What does life mean?
I don't know.
Life is, I don't know.
It's all about having fun. You've got to make the most of it. Live every day as if it's your last.
Following your dreams, to be happy, to have love, and to treat other people with respect.
I think happiness.
Life is not long. You don't want to waste it. Have a good time. Don't worry about what happened. Just do it.
If I can have one really good laugh every day for my whole life, I'll be happy.
Celebrate life. Life is too short.
Enjoying every moment of it.
Just enjoy life.
YOLO.
Really, my meaning in life is to teach people about God.
The true meaning and living of life is living it in Christ.
It's all about who you are, though. It's different for everybody.
I find that other people, they have their own reasons to have life, and I understand. It may seem a little self-centered, but I have to focus on what I fancy doing, what I enjoy.
Live your life how you want to live your life.
Like, the meaning of life is, like, to experience things.
Get out there and experience the world.
Everyone has their own meaning of happiness.
If you want to become something special, make something out of your life, then you got to do it yourself.
I see people that, like, you know, they mope their whole life, they're not happy. Or, like, I mean, obviously, if you have something bad to happen in your life, you know, mourn it. But then bounce back, have a good time. No matter what you are, who you are, just have a good time, that's it.
We're all sort of in the same pool, you know? You're trying to find where you're supposed to go with life.
The things people want to do these days tends to end up wrecking your life. And I think you should really just live life in a good way and live it according to the Bible. And then that's basically living life to the fullest.
I don't know. I don't know what our true purpose is here on
earth. No one knows the meaning of life. But I mean, maybe when you're on your deathbed, you might know the meaning of life to yourself, but it's an individual thing.
You ask that question and you'll get a thousand different answers. And it's been a question asked for a very long period of time. The whole book of Ecclesiastes in the Bible is Solomon's thoughts on what's the meaning of life, what's the purpose. And it's interesting that that girl in that piece came to the same conclusion that Solomon did, that you find real meaning in life when you obey what God tells you to do. And so it's amazing to see that much wisdom in a child. But what's disturbing about it is most of the people answer the question based on pleasure, that the main purpose of life is to have pleasure. That's an ancient doctrine, if you will, as well. It goes all the way back to the Greeks who posed it, and we have this wonderful word that came out of that, hedonism. So our culture seems to be severely slanted to a hedonistic answer to what's the meaning of life. And if the meaning of life is just to have pleasure, well, then we all know, and the Bible instructs us, that there's no end to that. The body is never satisfied. You can't fill it up. And all it does is create more hunger for the same thing. And each time it gives less and less pleasure. And the Greeks found that out, and that's why they rejected hedonism and came up with a wonderful motto, moderation in all things. Well, from a Christian standpoint, we've got to recognize that even Solomon wasn't right in Ecclesiastes, that the real meaning of life is found in God. Solomon didn't enjoy the kingdom of God. He spoke to God. God visited him. God gave him great wisdom. But Jesus is quite clear that all the prophets of the Old Testament weren't in the kingdom of God, that was reserved to us. And we look at Hebrews, at the end of chapter 11 in Hebrews, saying that we have something better. We have a better covenant that we can actually enter into communion, into fellowship with him. Now, some wonderful Christians got together in the year 1640 in Westminster. And there were Christians from the Scottish Church and from the English Church. And they posed the same question. What's the meaning of life? And here's their answer. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. I like to put it another way. Instead of asking what's the meaning of life, start asking what gives meaning to life. And it's only through a relationship with God and in service to others, glorifying him, that we get to the point of enjoying and finding meaning and purpose. Well, we've got some more answers that all came from our Facebook page. So
we did. We posed that to our Facebook audience, and we'd like to share with you what some of our friends said. Stephen said, the meaning of life is making a difference. If I have touched just one life along the way, then my life was not in vain. And then Larry says, it is the opportunity to share God's message with others and the time to grow a personal relationship with the Father over time.
Well, both of those are mirrors on the Westminster Catechism. If you want more information on that, there's a wonderful article on Wikipedia. And then people have actually posted the entire, it's called the Westminster Short Catechism. And it was required for all the young people in Scotland to be educated on this every single Saturday afternoon. John Knox put that as a rule for the entire country. And so go through it. I believe in studying what was important to the church fathers, what has been handed down as life lessons. And when you look at them, you can find a whole lot of meaning. Well, we want to introduce you to Broderick Adams. He discovered the meaning of life while spending 2 years in prison on drug charges after getting into a car accident that left him paralyzed.
As a boy, Broderick Adams went to church with his mother every Sunday. But it was the time he spent with his father the rest of the week that really shaped his life.
There was always a fear. There was always a fear on the inside of me, not knowing whether he would come home drunk or not, and if he did come home drunk, what was going to happen. Definitely physical abuse, but an extreme amount of verbal abuse.
I drank really hard, and I partied really hard. I didn't really necessarily want to be at home that much. I would rather be out drinking and partying. It had a lot of effect on our family, a tremendous amount.
When he was 13, Broderick quit going to church and followed in his father's footsteps. He started using drugs and alcohol.
You know, it just kind of numbed me up for the time being. Just kind of kept me out of reality, out of just trying to escape from the alcohol, from the abuse, from the fear, you know, and from seeing what my father was putting my mother through and my brother through and myself through. A lot of consequences, got in trouble with the police a lot, stayed in trouble at home with my parents a lot, stayed in trouble at school.
His lifestyle and consequences caught up with him when he was 19. After a long day of partying and drinking with friends, he got behind the wheel of his car and played chicken with oncoming traffic.
I would get into the oncoming lane and see how close I could get to that vehicle, you know, without hitting it and swerving back into my lane. When I swerved to get out of the way of the vehicle, that's when my vehicle started to flip. I was thrown out of the vehicle, but my best friend told me that after the vehicle stopped rolling, he had to kick his way out of the passenger side door. He finally found me about 20 to 30 feet out into the woods on the side of the road. And he told me that when he found me, I was covered in blood. And he told me he wouldn't even touch me because he knew that I had been severely injured.
Broderick spent the next 30 days in the intensive care unit of an Atlanta hospital. He was paralyzed from the chest down. When he finally returned home, the reality of his condition set in.
For the first 3 months or so after I got home from the hospital, I wouldn't even get out of the bed. I wouldn't barely eat. I wouldn't allow my parents to take care of me. I fell into a deep, deep depression.
When he realized that he could not walk or move, he would sit in the hallway in his wheelchair and wail, just wail and cry for hours on end. And there was nothing I could say or do. There was just nothing I could say or do.
As far as I was concerned, my life had been completely ripped away from me, and I saw absolutely no hope, saw absolutely no light at the end of that extremely dark tunnel, you know, and I was just on a downward spiral, you know. Things got extremely bad, extremely bad. My goal was to drink as much alcohol and do as many drugs as I possibly could in hopes of that I would definitely overdose. I definitely did not want to live, that was for sure.
He eventually got out of the house and back into the party scene. This time, the drugs and drinking got harder. Broderick was arrested for drugs and illegal gun possession and sentenced to 2 years in prison.
I was in prison. I was at the time 22 years old, paralyzed in a wheelchair. And I was facing probably the most difficult time that I had ever faced in my entire life. I finally realized that I had done things my way for 9 long years, and all I had done was mess up my life. And I definitely decided that, hey, I'm going to just turn it all over to God. I'm just going to, as the song goes, surrender all to Jesus Christ. Made the choice to face the rest of my life, you know, with Jesus Christ in my heart and the Holy Spirit leading me and guiding me. Over those next 2 years, you know, it was like going through God's schooling. You know, really, I just spent my entire day with the Lord.
He forgave his father for the years of abuse and prayed that he would turn his life over to Jesus and find freedom from alcohol. Before his sentence was over, his prayers were answered.
And he cried out to God, asking for mercy, and God showed mercy. And just right then and there, delivered him from the alcohol. And, you know, God definitely answered my prayers, that's for sure.
That day, I did get down on my knees. And from that day forward, things started turning around for me. I realize now what's important. I feel his presence. Once you get it, you don't want to lose it because it's the greatest thing that you've ever had or could get.
Broderick is out of prison and married. The scars on his body are a reminder of the consequences of the lifestyle he used to live.
I'm still living for God, and I wouldn't have it any other way. You know, and I've had every opportunity since I was released from prison to turn back to that lifestyle that I once lived. But, you know, I don't want to have anything to do with that lifestyle. You know, it did nothing but bring me down and destroy me. And becoming saved in Jesus Christ, in the name of Jesus Christ, well, has done everything in the world to lift me up. If you choose to obey God and you choose to believe on Jesus and ask him to come into your life and forgive you for all the wrong you've done and help you to live for him and help you to turn things around, that some amazing things will begin to take place in your life. God will definitely turn your tragedies into triumph and victory, you know. He'll definitely right your wrongs. Yeah, he's definitely done that for me.
And he'll do it for you. He loves to do it. He loves to restore. That's what Jesus came for. He didn't come for the righteous. He didn't come for those who think they're good enough. He came for sinners. And he took it as a badge of honor to be called a friend of sinners. That's what he wants to do. He came to seek and save those who were lost, who had lost their way in life, who had forgotten what it was like to have a relationship with their Creator that would be satisfying, that would give them meaning and purpose and give them enjoyment on a day-to-day basis. Now, he also promises, and this is true for all of us as part of the human condition, that in this life you'll have sorrow. In this life you'll have persecution. But he says, don't be afraid of that, because I have overcome the world. And his promise is that you will be with him for all eternity. What you experience with him in the here and now is just sort of a down payment. It's an earnest money deposit of what's to come. And Paul wrote, eyes have not seen, ears haven't heard what God has prepared for you and me. He wants us to live in a garden. He wants to come down in the cool of the evening and talk to us. He didn't want the creation to be subject to a curse. He didn't want us to fall from the grace that we had with him. But even though we did that, and even though we left, he still had a plan. And he still wants you to be with him. He still wants you to give joy, the peace that passes all understanding. He wants to give it to you free. And the great thing is, he's not asking you to get cleaned up. What he's saying is, I'll do that for you. I'll do that for you. Now, if you're like Broderick and you grew up the hard way, and then you made some bad choices of your own, and you started pursuing the things that the world offers that supposedly will give you pleasure and satisfaction. And if you've been there, you know at the end of that road, there's no pleasure anymore, and there's no satisfaction anymore, and there's no life anymore. Well, if that's you, Jesus came for you. And he can turn you around and show you joy unspeakable and full of glory. And you saw that. You saw that in that piece. You saw the change. You saw the light in their eyes, and you're wondering, how can I get that? Well, it's really easy. Ask Jesus to come into your heart. And it's a very simple prayer. Jesus, if you're there, if what you did for Broderick is real, could you do it for me? Could you show it for me? Could you be my Savior? Could you change my heart? Could you satisfy the longings, those deep ones, deep within your soul? Can you give me meaning? Can you give me purpose? The answer to all of that is yes. And Jesus will come if you just ask him. So if this is for you, if this is what you want, bow your head. Let's pray together. I'll lead. All you have to do is repeat. And what Jesus has done for others, he will do for you if you just let him. Let's pray. Jesus. That's right. Say it out loud. Don't be afraid. Jesus. I come to you, and I hear that you can give me meaning. You can give me purpose. That you can change my life. So, Jesus, I ask that you come into my heart, that you make me new again, that you take away the desire that I have for the things of this world, and you replace them for the desire for you. And, Jesus, if you'll do this, I want to follow you. So right now, I ask that you forgive me, that you change me, that you make me new. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, for those who just prayed, I ask for a baptism in your love. I ask that the peace that passes all understanding would just fill them and be in them and all around them. Hear their prayer. Answer it now, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed with me, the Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart and then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. What I want you to do is do that. Confess with your mouth that you just prayed, that you asked Jesus into your heart. The number's toll-free, 888-777-1999. When you call, I've got something for you. I want you to have it. It's a packet. It's called A New Day. And there's a CD teaching, How Do You Live the Christian Life? What are the next steps? What are the basics of the Christian faith? There's also a booklet filled with Bible verses. I encourage you to get a copy of the Bible. Start with the Gospel of John. But make that phone call. Do it now, 888-777-1999.
Well, up next, a mother deep in debt planned to commit suicide. Find out what stopped her. That's next.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer, that I decided,
if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else
and to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things. Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people and they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Every minute counts when you're fighting cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Hi, I'm Jeff Foxworthy. I've got a brand new game show coming to GSN. It has truly amazing contestants with great personal stories competing their hearts out to make a real difference in the world. And the team that proves they know the most about life and death, good and evil, love and lust, angels and demons, and redemption will win it all. I swear. And if I'm swearing, it must be good.
The American Bible Challenge premieres Thursday, August 23rd at 8, 7 Central, only on GSN.
All over the world, millions of people are trapped in a cycle of poverty and debt. Here's how one family broke that cycle for good.
Several times a week, the widow Prani walked with her elderly mother and baby to the village store to buy milk and rice for her four children. Prani was already deeply in debt to the store, with no way to repay.
I wanted to end my life, but then I realized that if I'm gone, the situation will be much worse.
After Prani's husband died, the family's only income came from her 16-year-old daughter's low-paying job at a restaurant. That's when Prani met some folks from CBN's Orphans Promise, who told her about a brand new program called Keeping Families Together. Here, the goal is to help families that feel the pressure to turn their children over to orphanages. For Prani's family, the most urgent need was more income. So Orphans Promise set up a small business for them to sell noodles and drinks outside their home. Business was strong right from the start, and within a few months, Prani was making twice as much as her daughter made at the restaurant. And the new business made it possible for Prani's daughter to quit her job and go back to school.
Orphans Promise gave our family a second chance. Our situation is better than before. My mom now has a business and doesn't have to work away from home.
And as for the debts at the local grocery store, they are now paid in full.
Thanks to CBN's Orphans Promise for helping me get back on my feet again.
You know, family, when it's healthy, is the place that we all flourish in. That's a God idea. That's one of the reasons that Orphans Promise has started this Keeping Families Together program. We work with lots of children who are in orphanages or children's homes, and there's always that heartbreak at the center of that, that something has been changed, taken from them, broken, that's not supposed to be. When we can keep families together, it helps the whole chain of things that happen negatively when they fall apart from happening. So we want to thank you for helping us with that. It takes such a little bit to make a difference in the lives of people who are hurting. Many, many children are in orphanages because their parents simply can't afford to take care of them. It's not that they don't love them. It's not that they don't want to be together as family. So help us make a difference. Join the 700 Club today. 65 cents a day, $20 a month makes you a 700 Club member. And when you join, we want to say thank you for caring about others by sending you the three blessings. This is Pat's latest teaching, and you're going to love it. It'll be a blessing in your life. So call that toll-free number, 1-888-777-1999, and say, I want to join the 700 Club. Gordon?
Well, we'll be back with your chat questions. Riley writes in, does God's will for us ever change? Well, stay tuned for our answer up next.
Jack Kennedy was asked the question, would he keep his church separate from his presidency? Now Mitt Romney faces the same scrutiny. While some voters distrust Mormonism, others see no issue. And one of those who isn't worried is Mitt Romney himself.
No authorities in my church will ever exert influence on presidential decisions.
Take a closer look at the Mormon faith and what it could mean to a Romney presidency on the 700 Club, next.
Hi, I'm Jeff Foxworthy, and I've got a brand new game show coming to GSN. It has truly amazing contestants with great personal stories competing their hearts out to make a real difference in the world. And the team that proves they know the most about life and death, good and evil, love and lust, angels and demons, and redemption will win it all. I swear. And if I'm swearing, it must be good.
The American Bible Challenge premieres Thursday, August 23rd at 8, 7 Central, only on GSN.
Christian singer Jimmy Needham on his double life.
For the better part of 4 years, it was a relentless battle and struggle for me, wanting to love and serve Jesus and be free, but then constantly doing the things I didn't want to do.
On the next 700 Club Interactive.
Well, we've got some chat questions. Let's go over to Demetria in the chat room.
Yes, Gordon, Terry, Riley asks a very profound question. He says, does God's will for us ever change? And if it doesn't, then does he still bless us if we are not doing exactly what he wants us to do?
Riley, that's a question for the ages. Let me answer it in two parts. Number one, I'll take the last part. If we're not acting perfectly, well, that just means you're human. None of us act perfectly. The Apostle John said, if we say we do not sin, we lie. Now, I don't know if you've ever done this as an exercise. I encourage Christians to do it. See if you can spend a Sabbath in accordance with the Torah. Just one day. Just try it. See if you can do that. Now, we know the Torah was handed down by God to Moses at Mount Sinai, and these are his instructions of how to live. And try it. See if you can do it. And see if you can do it for one day. I tried to do it. I lasted about 4 hours. I just read about don't kindle a fire on the Sabbath. And I go to the stove to heat up some broth. And I turn on, and I've got a gas stove. I turn it on, and I see the flames. And I just read don't kindle a fire. I just read it. And after I read it, I go and I sin right away. So if we say we don't sin, we lie. So does God still love us? Yeah. Does he justify the ungodly? Yeah. He still wants good things for you. He still wants to save you. He still wants you in his perfect will. Now, what I love to quote people about God's will and it not changing, I am the Lord, I change not. We're out here changing. We're doing funny things. We're doing things we know we shouldn't do. We're leaving undone things we should do. We're doing all of that. And God says, okay, I'm going to take all things and actively shape them together for your good. And he is able to present you spotless in his presence with exceeding joy. That's how great a salvation we have. You can trust it. Let's go back for one more question.
Well, we have Gary right now that needs actually prayer from us. He says that he's always felt worthless and living in people's shadow, as well as never understanding why God put him here on this earth. He asks us to pray for life and purpose for him.
I'll pray, and I'll pray after the show. But one thing you need to understand, in order to have purpose and meaning, you have to love others as you love yourself. And I would urge you, start loving yourself right now, because if you don't have that, you don't have it to give. Start understanding your worth and your significance to God, and then these other things will come into play. Well, that's all the time we have for today's show. We leave you these words from Ecclesiastes. Now all has been heard. There is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the duty of all mankind.